You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
The views expressed by the individuals during this broadcast are their own opinions, and they may not be the same as those of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
Must be full of reefer.
Full of reefer?
Yeah, man.
Mean that cat's high?
Failing.
Sailing.
Light.
We now wander off the beaten path with an update from the Reefer Reporter.
Oh my golly gosh, what a morning so far. Good morning. Hello and welcome to the Reefer Reporters. I'm Cindy Howell.
And I'm Ron McNabb, and we are live here from the Legacy420.com news desk.
We sure are, with all kinds of technical issues this morning. It is, oh my gosh, welcome to December, folks. It is December 2nd, 2021. And together, Ron and I are going to be bringing you the Global Reefer Reports here at paceradio.net. We got 10 stories on tap. We've had issues with lag this morning. We've had issues with internets being, messing up on us. Now we can't seem to broadcast live to any Facebook arena. We're having fun this morning, Ron.
We sure are, but we're still here, and we're gonna make this work for us. So,
absolutely, yep. Absolutely. So we are now heading over to our first story from CBC, and we are heading over. CBC is telling us that private cannabis New Brunswick stores are coming to the province to combat the black market.
Yes, New Brunswickers will soon have a wider range of outlet options for purchasing cannabis products. Finance Minister Ernie Steves introduced legislation Tuesday that will allow Cannabis N.B. to expand its model through private retail stores and direct from producers' farm gate operations. Currently, small producers sell their products through Cannabis N.B. and licensed retailers in other jurisdictions.
Well, that's fantastic for the small retailers to get out there, right? Steves has proposed amending the existing Cannabis Management Corporation Act and establishing a new Cannabis Retailers Licensing Act, noting that the move will bolster Cannabis New Brunswick against competition from the black market. I know people on both sides in Toronto, and the fact that they can have private stores and the stores can dress themselves up that they want, I think it helps, right? The new legislation and amendments, which were made in collaboration with Cannabis New Brunswick, will provide additional protections and safeguards and allow the agency to combat the higher number of illegal operations, Steve says. The new outlets will be like a mini Cannabis New Brunswick store, Steve's later explained to reporters.
Yeah, so it's an AGC location, and it'll just be a small version of what we already have. This is what Steve says. It won't be in corner stores. It won't be in gas stations or anything like that. It'll be in a standalone store, and it'll be a mini version of what we have right now. That's kind of different. I guess it's similar to what Ontario has for alcohol. For agencies in little stores, but interesting.
Yeah, well, it won't be in the corner stores or in gas stations.
Yeah,
it's gonna be in standalone stores like Toronto has, so, or Ontario has. So we'll have some, like, you know, you have tote cannabis. Tote cannabis can now come to New Brunswick on a smaller scale. Doesn't seem like they're going to close down the Cannabis New Brunswick stores, though.
Oh, yeah, I guess I just read that wrong. Early in the morning for me, I guess.
Yes. Yeah. Well, we were just discussing that with Al, how early in the morning it is
doing
these shows compared to some of the other shows on the network. Yeah. Some illegal pot contained mouse droppings, Steve. Ooh, wow. Well, like, I mean, I don't care where you're going to grow. And like, my goodness gracious, people keep claiming that there's some big thing, big difference between the two. Like, I mean, it's how you decide to feed it. There is, there's guano in really good soil. So, like, I mean, we're growing with bat droppings, right?
Yep.
The new legislation and expanded retail model would also help ensure that customers get what they're paying for and not less or more. We just did a test on some cannabis and we found out that there are some unpleasant items. One of the samples we got had mouse feces. This is all by Steve's. You know, he also called out illegally sold edibles such as gummies, which he said have been found in some cases to contain less THC than claimed. Well, you're going to probably find that in a lot of legal gummies as well, because, you know, like if you have a day that you're baking quick, I don't care if you're baking in a professional setting or at home, you're not going to mix as well. And that's how you don't get, you know, proper flow. And I mean, every good baker out there in the cannabis world goes through that. It's all about correct mixing, right?
Yeah, definitely. We found that he goes on to say that we found that they were announcing 15 milligrams of THC when in fact there were probably like 7 or 8 in there. You're going to have difference in like variances, as you said, with the way it's made and such. Cannabis New Brunswick has long complained about the ongoing saturation in the market by the illegal dispensaries. 2 years ago, in November 2019, then CEO Patrick Parent told the legislature that the sheer volume of black market cannabis was making it hard for the government-owned legal retailer to dominate the market and make money. Cannabis New Brunswick struggled to initially turn a profit, but has since turned a corner, adjusted prices, and posted record sales and profits.
Okay, so they're hitting their own nail on the head. Like, they were finding it hard to dominate and make money. Well, I can give you all kinds of reasons why. Like, I mean, 2 years ago, did you see the price of cannabis in the legal stores? Even if they were growing quads and it had no pesticides and it was all organic, like a lot of people want, they're still charging like $15 ish for most grams of cannabis. So nobody's going to go buy crap grown cannabis full of chemicals for $15 a gram. When you can go to your black market dude who's growing organically with bat guano and, you can get that. It tastes absolutely phenomenal. It's quads and you're only paying $5 a gram. That's a 10, you know, for most places, there's a $5 to $10 difference in the cost. So one of the things that they have to do is adjust their prices. It's definitely very, very important. It has also stressed that the products pose a potential health risk. That's a big argument that'll go back and forth forever between the gray market and the legal market. Even if they end up growing with the same everything, they're still going to argue that, because that's one of the ways that they try to gain people back, right?
Oh, yeah, products
that come from illegal companies are not tested or regulated, and there's no oversight of their production. Want to bet? we have all kinds of people that are willing to test cannabis products. I see gray market people, taking other people's products and their own and having them test it left, right, and center. So they are being tested. On Tuesday, Cannabis New Brunswick and Alcool New Brunswick liquor spokesperson Thomas Tremblay said that the illicit cannabis sales data was not readily available or reliable. Exactly. However, anecdotally, we have received a great number of consumers who have shifted from the illicit market to Cannabis New Brunswick because of the regulated and safety standards of our products. I know a lot of people that have shifted because, and I know a lot of people that go with the legal product just because I know a lot of veterans and their whole life has been about following the rules and making things better and protecting people. So they feel better, buying the quote unquote legal stuff. And, you know, if that's what makes them happy, power to them.
However, anecdotally, we have received a great number. You just read that. Tremblay echoed Steve's earlier statement that the province and the agency had worked in collaboration to develop the expanded sales model as the industry evolves. We are excited about future opportunities for the cannabis industry in New Brunswick and are looking forward to determining the best way forward to ensure education and access to safe, regulated products to consumers, he said.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like I wish these growers all the luck as I wish any growers, right? Like, I mean, like I I don't necessarily go into the liquor stores here in Nova Scotia and purchase the legal cannabis. I have gone in and gotten a few things just because my friends happen to own, you know, I happen to know the people that own that LP. But I mean, I don't purchase my monthly prescription via the liquor stores here. I apologize. I'm having all kinds of technical issues this morning, folks. I mean, like, man, I just keep clicking the invite button instead of the share button, wondering why the Chrome tab button isn't coming up, but I got it now.
And there we go. We are.
If I don't laugh at all this, I'm going to cry. So yeah, I'm going to have a good laugh. Coming to us from AureliaMatters.com, Huntsville school bus driver accused of being impaired by cannabis. I'm not going to call it a drug.
Yeah, the Huntsville Detachment of the Ontario Provincial Police have arrested and charged a 66-year-old male driver with impaired. On November 30th, 2021, at approximately 8:20 a.m., members of the Huntsville OPP were dispatched to the parking lot of the Huntsville High School as a result of a complaint from a concerned citizen that a school bus driver was impaired. On arrival, officers located the driver while speaking with him, detected an odor of cannabis along with other signs of impairment. A standardized field sobriety test was conducted, and the driver was transported to Huntsville Detachment for further testing, including a drug recognition expert evaluation.
So, yeah, I'm curious, and they don't answer these questions in this article, but I'm curious to what the concerned citizen saw. I mean, did she see them smoking a joint? Is this during the day? Why, like, are they, is he smoking a joint and then about to drive kids?
Yeah, there's not a lot of information in the story here.
Yeah, they detected an odor, which is okay. I understand that, but and other signs of impairment. What signs? I'm just really, really curious, right? Mm-hmm. As a result, this gentleman of Huntsville has been charged with operation of a motor vehicle while impaired by drug, contrary to Section 320.141A of the Criminal Code of Canada, Bedekafur. Was released from custody and is scheduled to appear January 19th, 2022 in an Ontario court. And the OPP is committed, they say here, to public safety, delivering proactive and innovative policing in partnership with our communities. But I'm really curious to what they saw.
I'm also curious to know whether this was a medical patient as well. If it was a medical patient, do they know what their rights are?
Oh, absolutely. And I agree. This is also a public job looking after little kids, right?
Yes. So, yeah. I'm not condoning it. I'm not weighing in a personal opinion on that matter there, but just, it's another thing to consider that it's a piece of the story.
Oh yeah. No, I mean, like, is he a patient? Does his employment know that he's a patient? Mm-hmm. But I mean, yeah, like, I mean, like, if he is a patient, there's got to be a way to not smoke a joint just before you drive kids.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's what I'm curious about. Was this at the end of the day? Was it parked? Was he about to go get in his own car? That kind of stuff. Right. So yeah, I'm curious of the whole situation because they don't tell us much besides they smelled some cannabis.
Yeah.
Was he laughing? Was he jovial? How does that tell you that he's impaired? Like, that's kind of the stuff that I'm curious about. And I really would like to hear more as this goes forward, because I hope this gentleman gets a good. I'm curious.
Yeah, definitely. I am too. It's one I'm going to try to follow up on. It's only about an hour away from where I live too. So.
Oh yeah. So you'll have good resources to keep an eye on for sure.
Yeah.
We're going to head over to Mugglehead Magazine. And over at Mugglehead, they're telling us that Ontario reduces cannabis retail applicant inspection process.
Yeah, this is very interesting. I found this story late last night. Ontario's cannabis regulator is cutting the number of inspections that new stores are required to undergo before opening. In a statement Wednesday, the Alcohol and Gaming Commission of Ontario said that retail applicants will now have to pass a virtual educational session and a single integrated inspection focused on high-risk compliance criteria. Previously, prospective stores underwent an educational session and two inspections before opening.
Yeah. Interesting. I wonder what they're inspecting for. I mean, like, I can understand that... I'm always curious. I'm in a curious state of mind today, I guess. Mm-hmm. After considering feedback from industry stakeholders, the AGCO says it's changing the cannabis store inspection process to make it more efficient and reduce the burden on licensees, while maintaining the same rigorous compliance criteria that applicants must meet before the store can open. I know a few people that have gone and taken this this virtual education session, via the stores that they work for. They don't necessarily tell us everything that they teach, right?
Right.
But the change doesn't directly impact retailers very much, says Jenna McLean, who is the co-owner of Calyx and Trichrome's cannabis. The second inspection was always a bit redundant. That was probably a burden on the AGCO, she explains. The rules are really straightforward, so both of her stores were functionally ready at the pre-inspection stage. Yeah, so she sees it as a positive change.
Yeah, she sees it as a positive change. It'll ease the burden on the AGCO, who also have alcohol, casinos, et cetera, to monitor, which will ultimately cut down on wait times for licensing, which is what Ontario's been waiting for quite some time. Some people are waiting for stores for like a year to open up. I believe it's a little quicker now, but it's been not very great in the past. As of November 29th, cannabis store applicants will no longer have to complete a pre-opening inspection. Lower risk compliance criteria will now be checked once a store is opened and as a part of ongoing compliance inspections, the AGCO says. Stores will still have to meet the same compliance criteria.
Yeah. So the AGCO is confident that our streamlined compliance inspection process maintains the same rigorous authorization standards and expectations of honesty and integrity from our cannabis licensees. Pardon me. Ontario has increased the rate of new cannabis shop approvals several times over the past 2 years, which is true. Yeah. The following is required for applicants before November 29th, mandatory education, pre-authorization inspection, pre-opening inspection, and ongoing compliance inspections once the store is open. And now they have the mandatory virtual education session still. Pre-authorization inspection, which includes all high-risk criteria previously included in pre-opening inspections. And then they have the ongoing inspections once the store is open, which includes all low-risk criteria from the pre-opening inspections. And the following is required for operators with existing stores on or after 29th. They still need their virtual education. Pretty much the same thing as the last segment I just read. So they're just cutting out one inspection, really.
It'll obviously make things easier for the AGCO, but it'll also in turn speed up the process for the stores.
Yeah, save money and speed it up. That's those are good things.
Yep,
strange for a government.
I have a feeling it was for their benefit, and in the benefit for the stores just was a secondary nature of it. So
I agree with you on that one. I'm clicking the right buttons this time. I'm so proud of me. Okay.
And I'm waiting, and there we go.
It's coming. We're heading over to the Winnipeg Sun. The MMF signs on for cannabis research project.
Yes, newly signed agreement will allow the Manitoba Métis Federation to take a hard look at the benefits that medical cannabis could have in treating illnesses and ailments that many Métis people currently live with and suffer with. This is important because we know that cannabis has medicinal uses and can be powerful in helping people, MMF President David Chartrand said. And we know that so many of our people are suffering and looking for ways to stop their pain and suffering. Last week, the MMF announced that they had entered into a memorandum of understanding with the Green Mountain Health Alliance and the Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center to collaborate on what they said would be high-quality research to advance our understanding of cannabis as a medical therapy and to improve health outcomes for the Manitoba Métis.
Excellent.
That's excellent. Pretty cool.
Yeah. Chartrand said the MMF believes that the opportunity to form partnerships that will result in medical cannabis research is important because, he said, Manitoba Métis people currently have high rates of chronic illnesses and, in many cases, illnesses that cause chronic pain and lack of mobility. And we all know that cannabis can help with that. Mm-hmm, we have the highest rates of arthritis and rheumatoid arthritis of any indigenous group in the province, Chartrand said. So we think that this is going to be very beneficial for our people and very educational at the same time. He said he would also like to see medical cannabis explored as a way for seniors and elders to get relief from pain. As he said, many elders currently suffer with arthritis, Parkinson's, and other diseases and illnesses that can cause pain and lead to lack of mobility. Yeah, these are terrible diseases, and cannabis can really go a long way in helping all of that.
Definitely, definitely. He goes on to say, we have to have the education, that education, because we know that some still see it as a bad drug and a drug that is illegal. So they don't want anything to do with it, he said. But I think people will slowly grasp that most medicines come from plants. So we can try to educate our people and seniors that we can trust cannabis and that it is something that could help you during challenging times. Most definitely. Chartrand added that chronic illnesses within the Métis community can also lead to mental health issues. And that is another reason he believes the new research partnership is important.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Pain can cause mental anguish in a heartbeat. Yeah. Mm-hmm. These illnesses just take the spirit right out of people because they can't do many things that they used to be able to do. Oh, I feel that. And they often can't drive or get around. So it's very hard on people's mental well-being as well. We believe that through cannabis, we might be able to start helping people find that mobility and find some people, find some peace and freedom from pain, and not just from the physical pain, but from the mental pain. According to the MMF, the new agreement will increase cannabis research and development with world-leading scientists, pardon me, contribute to knowledge of the effect of cannabis consumption and determine which cannabinoids or smokes work most effectively for a range of symptoms. That's really fantastic. I love to see people fighting for their citizens, for the people that are close to them.
Definitely.
And I hope that they're able to find all of the help and education that they're searching for.
Definitely, most definitely. It can be beneficial to so many people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I did good on that last switch. I mean, I got to press, click the buttons and put it up before we even knew what was going on. Heading over to Trident and heading down to the United States. CDC issues cannabis guidance for businesses that employ drivers. Well, I'm interested to read this story.
Yeah, the Centers for Disease Control, otherwise known as the CDC, has shared guidance for employers who use drivers in their business on cannabis policies in the workplace. Posted on the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health's news website, the agency says due to rising cannabis use rates in the U.S. and the fact that cannabis is only second to alcohol as the most prevalent drug in post-crash testing. The substance needs to be addressed as part of all workplace motor vehicle safety programs.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
I'm just going to interrupt here, then I'll let you go on because I don't necessarily believe that cannabis you know, I can drive after using a little bit of cannabis, using too much cannabis. I know better. I don't want to drive. But I believe that there has to be a way to give people exemptions. There was one person here in Nova Scotia years ago who gained an exception. He had MS, and he fought hard to get this exemption, and they tested him rigorously. Holy Joe Ditzel, I'm not even reading a word and it's not coming out of my mouth. Rigorously, before giving him an exemption. And I think that, you know, that's fine. I mean, like, you know, like I remember being, especially when I first started smoking cannabis, there is no way that I should be driving while I was that stoned, right?
Same here.
But, you know, 35, 40 years of using, well, 35 years, because I'm only 50, 40 years put me at 10. So 15 on, I can mean, like, you know, 30 years later, I mean, yeah, I can smoke a joint and I'm not high like I was 35 years ago. Right. Mm-hmm. It's a lot different. And I think that there's got to be ways to figure that out. So people like this bus driver, if he's actually okay, can do what he needs to do to medicate, to deal with and do his job well. You know, but that being said, somebody who's new, if they're trying to medicate before driving, well, no, they shouldn't be driving themselves or one other person or a bus full of people.
Mm-hmm. True. Anyway, true.
That's just my personal opinion. And I had to interrupt and to kind of stick that in.
No, that's good information. So thank you for chiming in there. In the post, they remind readers that cannabis affects parts of the brain that control movements, balance, coordination, memory, and judgment. They say cannabis use may slow down reaction time and point to studies that have shown being in a crash increase after cannabis use. However, the CDC says that cannabis's specific contribution to crash risk is unclear because it can be detected in body fluids for days or weeks after
I'm rubbing off on you, my friend.
Yeah, I will try that again. However, the CDC says that cannabis's specific contribution to crash risk is unclear because it can be detected in body fluids for days or weeks, even weeks after use.
Yes.
Instead of advising a blanket no tolerance policy, the CDC calls for a more nuanced approach depending on the cannabis laws in the state line in the state the business is located. However, they encourage a zero tolerance policy when it comes to cannabis use at work, explicitly mentioning on the job cannabis use and cannabis use prior to work as no-nos.
So like the CDC is calling for a nuanced approach, like kind of like that's what I was saying earlier. There's got to be some approach that will determine. It's like, because it's the same as, like, I mean, like, you know, like you we all know that the longer we use it, the more we need. So the less stoned we are with a joint, we need 5 joints to get what we got 5 years ago. If we want to get stoned, not if we want to just get medicated and kill pain. You know, there becomes a difference. So, here it says, despite some unanswered questions about cannabis's role in crash risk, workers under the influence of cannabis do not have the skills needed to drive safely, the NIOSH wrote. The past outlines a host of other suggestions, like, you know, partnering with an attorney to review drug policies and to be very clear about drug testing and the conditions and circumstances one may be required. They advise employers to explain to drivers that consuming CBD products may be risky as the labels may not accurately reflect THC concentrations, which could lead to a failed drug test. Notice how they put that too. They're saying that, you know, be careful of your CBC products. It may have some THC, which may give you a failed drug test. It doesn't say anything about it may affect your ability to do something.
It's just speaking to the test only.
So
the CDC also recommends driver education around impaired driving and suggests managers stay up to date on relevant cannabis laws in their state.
Yes, because the laws are going to continue to change because people like me are going to speak up and like the person I was telling you about and many, many, many others are going to speak up and say, hey, yo, I'm not always stoned. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, there's got to be a way. And I mean, and I know that the lawmakers are still trying to figure this out. So they're going with a blanket. Just don't do it right now while they're figuring it out. I get that. As annoying as it may seem to seasoned users like you and I.
Yeah. Yeah. They obviously have to have all the studies and everything out in front of them to create, to open up the laws more, to relax them and that. So,
yes. And they have to figure out how to test us when we drive. They have to figure out how, you know, like, how do we know that Cindy's too stoned to drive and Cindy's not too stoned to drive? Like, you know,
exactly.
And that takes a lot of figuring. So I can mean power to the scientists that are doing that. But with that, guess what? It's medication time. We get to go have dab, which means we're going to hear from our sponsors and pay some bills. Then Ron and I are going to be back right after the break with five more stories. And as for right now, we are the Reefer Reporters, and we are live here at PaceRadio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At VMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. VMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at vmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At VMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. VMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit vmahydroponics.com.
CTCP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Pace Radio is the People Advocating Cannabis Education Radio Network.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
The People Advocating Cannabis Education Radio Network, found at paceradio.net, provides its listeners with news, information, and a place to be heard. This is done through our 5 weekly live video and audio broadcasts that cover cannabis and psychedelic news, plus those we interview. We get started Monday at 10 a.m. Eastern with the Reefer Reporters. Then at 9 p.m. we're live with Canna Quebec. Tuesday brings you Open Your Eye or the Psychedelic Reporters at 7 p.m. Wednesday at 8, we are live with the Pace Radio Show. But we're not done yet, because on Thursday, the Reefer Reporters return with another Reefer Report. Meanwhile, once a month, Thursdays bring you The Grassroots Advocate, the Pace Radio Network's audio magazine. All these shows, plus more, are found right here on paceradio.net.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
Well, everything's working, knock on wood. The second half, knock on wood. So far, the second half is going much better than the first half, how the first half started. So we're back, yay, from our medication session. And we are the Reefer Reporters. And if you're not sure, yeah, we are live here at paceradio.net.
Yes, we are. And if you miss our live shows, don't forget they are available afterwards as a podcast on our website or on audio apps such as Spreaker, Spotify, CastBox, SoundCloud Plus, as Google and Apple Podcasts.
Absolutely. We're all over the place. We're just not broadcasting live on Facebook right now. And with that, we are popping over to Ganjapreneur, and we're still down in the United States. Vermont Medical Society calls for 15% THC limits.
Yeah, kind of intriguing. The Vermont Medical Society, the VMS, last month adopted a resolution calling for a 15% THC limit on adult use cannabis products in the state. The VMS board said that the state has the nation's highest past month cannabis use in including use of high potency greater than 15% THC, and noted that the Vermont Department of Health said last year that cannabis use is a significant public health problem in Vermont, and it is getting worse. Not sure where they're getting that information from, but well, we'll move on. The resolution amends and replaces the board's 2018 resolution, which opposed legalized cannabis for adults. The society represents 2,400 physicians and physician assistants throughout the state.
Okay.
You can't make this stuff up.
No, I'm a professional reporter. I'm going to stop laughing at the story and read now. The board cites several studies that suggest using cannabis with THC levels higher than 15% is associated, dear Lord, I'm going to have to read this, with increased urgent and emergency department psychiatric visits and increased mental health disorders, including psychosis. The resolution also points to one study published in 2019 that found using high THC products is associated with increased urgent and emergency department non-psychiatric visits, including respiratory distress, often associated with overcrowding or overutilization of emergency room facilities.
Yeah, VMS strongly opposes the advertising, marketing, and promotion of cannabis in the state of Vermont, including through the use of packaging, flavorings, and placement density of retail locations. This is just a quote in here. I'll continue with the quote and then continue with the story. We're live. How can you tell? Anyways, flavorings and placement density of retail locations in order to disincentivize establishments from pushing sales through fostering high use and addiction, given that 80% of product will be consumed by 20% or less of users, notably those with current or future dependence or addiction to cannabis. This is coming from the Vermont Media Society. That's their position on commercialized sales of cannabis on November 17th, 2021.
Folks, if you could see my face, you would see my jaw sitting on the floor like, what?
Yeah. I guess I would be considered one of those ones on future, like on current and future dependence of cannabis to manage my conditions instead of using pharma. Anyways, the board is calling for cannabis packaging and advertising to include warnings about psychosis, impaired driving, addiction, suicide attempt, and uncontrollable vomiting, and harmful and harm to fetuses and or nursing babies.
Okay. I gotta say something here. These doctors, don't they realize that us women, when we're feeding our babies with our boobies, we're giving them cannabinoids. We're making mm-hmm. them naturally and going, yo, babies, here you go, get high
mm-hmm.
off our milk that we're producing, even if we don't ingest cannabis.
Anyone ever hear the term milk drunk?
Oh my God.
That's where that comes from.
And there's a reason why we give our kids cannabis. Like, I mean, the first year of your life, it's so painful. It's no wonder our bodies are made to produce that in the milk to give to the kids naturally. I mean, like, there's got to be some way to, like, ease their pain of teething, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Adult use cannabis sales are expected to launch in Vermont in October 2022. The state legalized cannabis for adults in 2018, but the reforms did not include commercial sales. Interesting.
I can't wait. I'm going to go to Vermont and I'm going to purchase some legal cannabis and I'm going to go stand in the middle of Vermont and I'm going to roll a big old stogie and I'm going to smoke it.
Sounds like a plan.
Yeah. Come on, everybody. Let's next, not the summer coming, but the summer after that, let's plan a trip to Vermont and we'll all go down there and we'll smoke a big stogie in the middle of Vermont. I think that would be a blast. All of us crazy Canadian cannabis addicts are here.
Mm-hmm, definitely. And I guess you're back to clicking buttons, and there we go. I'm clicking buttons.
I was sorry. I medicated during the last break, and now I'm high, so I couldn't talk and click buttons at the same time. But I'm back now. And now we're back to this wonderful.com. How did we decide that this was pronounced Macau?
Macau, I believe.
Yeah, MacauBusiness.com. And coming to us from them is we're heading to Mexico. Mexican court allows subsidiary of Canadian company to grow cannabis.
Yeah, Mexico's Supreme Court on Wednesday issued the country's first ever authorization for planting, cultivating, and harvesting cannabis for industrial purposes. It granted the right to a wholly owned subsidiary of the Canadian firm Zebra Brands, which cultivates hemp and produces products such as cannabis-infused drinks. Cannabis became legal in Canada, as we all know, in 2018.
Yeah. Yeah. While industrial cannabis production is still illegal in Mexico. Good Lord, I have to cough every time I start talking. A country racked by decades of drug wars, the court responded positively to an injunction against the prohibited field by the firm Desert MX, a Mexican subsidiary of a Vancouver-based firm. The ruling obliges the firm to guarantee that the plant produces concentrations equal to or less than 1% of THC, which is the active substance, get high substance of the plant, of course. It added that the production must meet the monitoring, control, and security conditions of the competent authority, competent authority deemed appropriate to protect health and public order. So I can be like, they're looking at hemp only right now, but that can mean like it's still a step forward.
It is. It definitely is. It's a step forward.
Yeah.
Then it's better than going backward.
Yeah. And it produces a lot of CBD. It can also, I mean, like the hemp products that you can make with this, like, you know, the non-eating or smoking products, like, I mean, clothes and hemp wood and hempcrete and all of that can be made in Mexico.
Yeah. Yeah. My screen just jumped here on me here. Pardon me. Ruling is the latest issued by the Supreme Court in recent years to loosen prohibitions on the use of hemp. The court this year decriminalized the recreational use of cannabis and instructed Congress to legislate on the matter, although the bill is still under debate in the Senate after the lower house approved it. We've been following that story for a little while now. Uruguay and Colombia have the most advanced regulations on the production, marketing, and export of cannabis in Latin America.
Yeah, I've got a friend that's working with people in Colombia in the cannabis field, and it's a lot of fun to watch what they're doing over there. Mm-hmm. In December 2013, Uruguay became the first country in the world to legalize the production, distribution, and consumption of cannabis. And for its part, Colombia authorized the industrial use of cannabis and its export for medicinal purposes this past July. Mexico is going to start growing a lot of hemp.
Definitely, yeah. And my computer is being stupid on me again.
Is your computer? Oh, sorry, folks. It has been a day of technical, wonderful stuff here at the Reefer Reporters. But I mean, we're still going to get everything out to you. I mean, Ron, once he gets his computer catching up to him again, he will let me know. I am sure. Until then, I'm going to let you know, Ron, that I have stopped sharing the last one. We are heading over to MaryJane.com, and we're going to talk about Dubai. And Dubai will no longer imprison tourists caught with cannabis.
Yeah, my whole system is frozen right now, Cindy.
Okay, I'll keep talking. If you have comments, chime in. Tourists who are caught with cannabis in Dubai will no longer face excessive prison sentences, thanks to a major overhaul of the United Arab Emirates, extreme drug prohibition laws. The major reform, which was announced last week by the UAE President Skeen Khalifa Zayed Al Nayan. Okay, that's the last time I'm going to say that long name. They will just be the president from now on. Aims to modernize the country's antiquated drug laws by prioritizing treatment over punishment. Once the law takes effect in January of 2022, January 2nd, actually 1 month from today, tourists caught entering Dubai with cannabis or THC-infused products will no longer be charged with a criminal offense. Instead, police will simply confiscate and destroy any contraband cannabis. Under the UAE's current drug law, anyone caught possessing even a residual amount of cannabis can be sentenced to a minimum of two years in jail. Wow. This penalty even applies to anyone with residual weed in their system, too. Wow.
Wow.
Wow. Wow. Oh, my gosh. Wow. Last year, Dubai police arrested Peter Clark, an American citizen, after he tested positive for THC on a routine drug test during an emergency hospital visit. Clark did not even bring cannabis to the UAE, though he had simply gotten high on legal pot in Nevada before his trip. He was eventually released after 2 months, but still had to cough up a $50,000 fine and, to pay his fines and legal fees. That's just crazy.
That's crazy, crazy. And I'm back. I am back. Yay. The new law also reduces the mandatory minimum sentence for first-time drug possession to 3 months, down from 2 years. Courts will still have the option of imposing massive fines for the first-time offenses, though, ranging from I'm not sure what currency that is. I guess the conversion is $5,445. I would assume that's U.S. Mm-hmm. to $27,255 U.S. A second offense carries a 6 month mandatory minimum, and a third offense is punishable by at least 2 years in jail and a fine of $27,225 US or more. That's crazy. Anyways, we can clearly see a recognition of the need for a coordinated approach that considers criminal justice and public health in regards to using drugs. Dr. Hassan Al-Hayes, a legal consultant of Al-Rawad Advocates, told the National News, while justice is at the heart of the new law, we can also see how the issue of using drugs is being looked at as an illness rather than a crime.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, that's the way that the world is finally starting to look at addiction, like the illness that it actually is.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's like happening all over.
Yeah, we don't put people in jail for having arthritis or cancer or Parkinson's. Why should we put them in jail for having addiction? It's nice to see that it's finally being treated like the health issue that it truly is, right?
Exactly.
And everywhere, including in Dubai. Instead of being locked in prison with violent criminals, drug offenders will be sent to secure detention centers offering rehab and treatment services, sports, and vocational training. And instead of mandatorily deporting expats who are caught with also be allowed to decide whether or not to deport foreign citizens for minor drug offenses on a case-by-case basis. In this recent change, reform is further prioritized. Offenders are given a second chance and are spared loss of successful futures and decent living that they have in the country. Said a senior judge at the Dubai Civil Court. Now it's becoming flexible in terms of allowing judges to decide it rather than keeping it mandatory. For example, someone in court for using a controlled medicine without a prescription must be deported according to the previous law, but now they are given a second chance.
Yeah, that's good to see. But I think they're still going a little bit too far, but hey, yeah. That's just my opinion. But
yeah. They're moving forward, and hopefully they keep doing so. Obviously, we read here a minute ago, I think it was you who read it, that there is a doctor that is saying, look at it. It's not a legal case. This is a medical case when you're looking at addiction. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely. But although the new law decreases penalties for common possession and use, it increases the fines for anyone caught selling or trafficking drugs. The penalty for encouraging personal drug use, among others, will increase from 20,000 DH to 50,000 DH with a mandatory minimum of 5 years in jail. In cases where the courts find someone responsible for causing serious harm related to drug trafficking, the penalty rises to DH 200,000 and to at least 10 years behind bars. Wow.
Yeah. Small steps, but they are coming forward, but small steps.
Yep, definitely. Definitely.
Yeah. Yep. So the next story is actually coming to us from Forbes. It caught my eye because I have a friend that was just visiting Malta. So when I saw the story, it's like, oh gosh, I have to, pull this one out, because my friend Tracy just returned from Malta. She spent a couple of weeks over there. And it was beautiful and warm and rooftop pools. And now Malta is to legalize cannabis for personal use, social clubs, but not for sales.
Let's see what they have to say about this. Malta is to legalize cannabis. Its citizens will be able to grow cannabis at home and establish cannabis social clubs. The cannabis reform bill has now to pass in Parliament for the third reading and final vote. It is expected to become law in 2 weeks. The legalization process started this year when the Ministry for Equality, Research and Innovation of the smallest country in the European Union introduced in October 2021 a bill to reform law on cannabis.
Which is really awesome. Now, my friend that was over there, Tracy, she is she's a cannabis activist, a cannabis advocate, medical cannabis user, and she's over there for 2 weeks, unable to use any of it because, of course, right now the laws are quite stringent. So to find out that she gets home, 2.5 weeks before it should be legalized over there for personal use. Sorry, Tracy, but at least the next time you go back, sweetheart, you're going to be able to use cannabis over there. Such an initiative follows the government's election manifesto in 2017, which pledged to launch a debate on cannabis for recreational use. In March 2021, the Maltese government published a white paper outlining its vision on cannabis policy. The bill, presented for its first reading on the 4th of October 2021, involved the work of legal experts, scientists, and people from other sectors. The reform bill lies on four pillars: cultivation, possession, consumption, and association.
Yeah, adult cannabis consumers will be able to possess up to 7 grams. However, possession of more than 7 grams will be punished with administrative penalties. Cannabis consumption in public will be forbidden unless the person is authorized to use it for medical reasons. The bill also allows, isn't all cannabis really medical though? Even if you're using it recreationally, you still get the medical benefits. Yes. The bill also, whether you realize it or not, quite often you don't until you look back on it or someone mentions it to you. The bill also allows growing up to 4 cannabis plants at home. However, plants shouldn't be visible from other places. When cultivating cannabis plants at home, consumers can keep up to 50 grams of dried cannabis in the household. Do they know how much a plant can produce?
Yeah. You can grow 4 plants. But when you bring the first one down and you get 90 grams of that, of dried cannabis, you can only keep 50 of that. And then the other plants are only to look at. Following the Spanish formula of the cannabis social clubs, the bill establishes the permission to create nonprofit organizations to distribute cannabis products among members. Each member can't belong to more than one association. I can have 4 names. The bill to create and regulate a cannabis market like in the United States. However, it aims to decriminalize the responsible use of cannabis, fight back illicit drug trafficking, and expunge criminal records of people found guilty of possession of cannabis for their personal use, according to the local newspaper. Local news media outlet Malta Today reported that the opposition MPs and some organizations requested clarification about the proposed cannabis authorities' role in implementing cannabis decriminalization for personal use with an educational campaign during the last discussion. Furthermore, they raised concern over the age limit for cannabis consumption. They proposed to raise from 18 to 25. They offered to extend the distance from a cannabis club to a school from 250 meters to 1 kilometer and limit the THC potency.
However, Reforms Minister Owen Bonici explained that further limitations on age limit and THC level would create a new black market that would jeopardize the efforts of the current bill. In the end, opposition MPs haven't put forward substantial amendments. Before this cannabis reform, Malta introduced new policies to decriminalize cannabis partially in 2015. 3 years later, it legalized medical cannabis with a prescription.
But with this move, Malta may become the first European Union country to legalize growing cannabis for personal use, overtaking Luxembourg, which is still refining its draft bill on recreational cannabis. The adoption of the Cannabis Socials Club formula has prevailed over the full commercialization of cannabis. However, it is unclear how the clubs will be structured. They probably still have some working out to do with that. The cannabis reform in Malta is a symptom of hectic legislative activities in the old continent. Several European countries are overhauling their drug policy, finding a way to decriminalize or even regulate cannabis consumption for personal use. Of course they are. It's just, like the world is heading towards natural medicine, and cannabis is the first one on everybody's mind.
Mm-hmm, definitely. It's been around for thousands of years.
Yep.
And although hold on, I missed where we are.
As mentioned,
Luxembourg is to legalize growing for personal use. The new German ruling coalition has put cannabis legalization on its political agenda. Italy is waiting to vote for a referendum to decriminalize personal use and legalize cultivation next year. Other pilot projects to regulate cannabis possession are to start in the Netherlands and Switzerland. Although there is no bill, only Germany seems seriously thinking of creating a cannabis market in this context. Other countries seem to find a mild solution to legalize cannabis consumption for personal use without fully regulating the cannabis market.
Yeah. Yeah. So the European Union is really, like, I mean, everybody over there is really getting on board. They're coming forward. They're all kind of looking at it now. And that's really exciting.
Mm-hmm. It definitely is.
That's kind of where we are, where we were a few years ago. And do you remember how excited we all were? Even like the laws were terrible, the prices were horrible.
It's a start.
Before we got to purchase it at a legal store. But it was exciting to go from illegal to legal.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a start. It's like it I keep saying, you can't undo 100 years of prohibition in 2 days or three years.
It's going to take quite a while, but it's really exciting to be alive, to be watching it happen. And we're heading over to our 10th and final story of the day. You know, now that we've got all of our technical glitches worked out, holy Joe Gitzel, we're heading over to the medical cannabis brief. Coming to us from them, a record number of scientific papers published about cannabis in 2021. This one caught my eye because I giggled when I read it. And like, oh my gosh, has there ever been?
Yeah, yeah. I was quite surprised the numbers here. In the first 11 months of this year, 2021, researchers worldwide published a record 3,800 plus scientific papers on the subject of cannabis, according to the results of a keyword search of the National Library of Medicine PubMed.gov website. This exceeds the total number of papers published during all of last year. In 2020, scientists published 3,500 plus papers on cannabis peer-reviewed journals, or in peer-reviewed journals, a total of which was at that time the most ever in a single year. Despite claims by some that cannabis has yet to be the subject to adequate scientific scrutiny, scientists' interest in studying cannabis has increased exponentially in recent years and has our understanding of the plant, its constituents, their mechanisms of action, and their effects on the user and upon society. That was said by Paul Armentano, Normal's deputy director. It's time for politicians and others to stop assessing cannabis through the lens of what we don't know and instead start engaging in evidence-based discussions about cannabis and cannabis reform policies that are indicative of all that we do know.
Oh, Paul, yeah.
Common sense still does exist.
Yeah, what you said. That's fantastic. Awesome. I love that line. Yeah. Since 2010, scientists have published an estimated 27,000 peer-reviewed papers specific to cannabis, with the annual number of total papers increasing every year. By comparison, researchers published fewer than 3,000 total papers about cannabis in the years between 1990 to 1999, and fewer than 2,000 total studies during the 1980s. Wow. It's really, really jumped, hey? A 2018 paper assessing trends in cannabis-related publications concluded that much of the uptick in scientific interest is a result of researchers' newfound focus on cannabis therapeutic activities. Investigators reported that the total number of peer-reviewed publications dedicated to medical cannabis has increased ninefold since the year 2000. In November, Normal published an updated edition of the compendium, Clinical Applications for Cannabis and Cannabinoids, a review of the recent scientific literature 2000 to 2021, which reviews over 450 peer-reviewed studies assessing the safety and efficacy either of whole plant cannabis or individual cannabinoids in 23 different patient populations, including autism, chronic pain, diabetes, fibro, migraine, and PTSD. Copies of the book are available for download in the Kindle app, and software copies are available in the Normal store. That sounds like it would be an interesting publication.
I'm going to be looking into that as soon as the show is done. Well, not as soon as the show, but sooner rather than later. That's really intriguing.
Yeah.
In all, PubMed.gov now cites over 30, there's obviously a typo in there. I would have to say that's probably 38,500 scientific papers on cannabis available to the public online since 1996, PubMed is a free resource supporting the search and retrieval of biomedical and life sciences literature.
Yeah, I don't think I'm going to close the story. I think I'm going to go back and and take a look here myself later on this afternoon and see what that download is all about, because that sounds really interesting. Yeah. Especially when you have to go have a chat with a doctor who says, we need more research. Oh, yeah?
Pachar. Here it is.
Take a look right at that. There. Right?
Yep.
Yeah, that's really cool. Well, Ron, cool. With all the technical difficulties, with everything that happened, the fact that we had a late start because it wouldn't post to Facebook, and then it stopped the broadcast, and then it booted you out, and then everything else we've had going on. You know what, my friend? We made it to the end.
We did.
We got 10 stories out.
And
our Reefer reporters for today, December 2nd, 2021.
And we'd like to thank you for joining us here today at Legacy420.com News Desk.
We sure would. Thanks for listening to our Global Reefer Reporter here at PaceRadio.net. You know what? If you enjoyed it, share it out with the people that you love and even the people that you don't, because you know what? It didn't publish to Facebook for us, so we need all the shares we can get today. And with that, I am wishing you and my joint host, Ron, an absolutely wonderful rest of your day.
Cheers, all.
The opinions of the individuals during this broadcast are their own and may not be the opinions of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at PaceRadio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at PaceRadio.net.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
What do you find at PaceRadio.net? People advocating cannabis education.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
We are people advocating cannabis education here at PaceRadio.net.